Now, let's talk a little bit. Oh, let me finish this other piece here. When in women's brains, language and emotion are very close to each other. And we women have language spots all over our brain. You guys have very specific language spots, and they're all on one side of your brain. If you have brain damage on that side, it's very difficult for you to get language back. If we women have brain damage, it's easier for us because our brain can rewire itself. There are a lot more centers, all right? You guys, your emotions are in what's called the amygdala of the brain. It's a totally different part of the brain. When we women say to you guys, well, just talk to me about your feelings, you can't do it because you have to stop, think, go to the place in your brain where your emotions are stored, work through them, and then you can talk about them, okay? But we women think you work the same way we do, so you should just be able to, you know, free associate and talk about your emotions, and it's not true. We have to be very respectful of that. As women, we need to know that when we talk to our boyfriends, our husbands, that if we have something really important to talk about, we set a time and we stick to the point. Because men are focused, okay? And we're doing this business. He didn't know what you're talking about, okay? And even as we listen to each other, you guys need to know that if your girlfriend, your wife is talking to you, you should say to her, am I supposed to listen like a guy or like a girl? What does that mean? Well, it means if you're listening as a girl, you just listen. You don't have to fix it. Because sometimes we women just have to talk, all right? You guys intuitively want to fix it. That's who you are, all right? But sometimes that makes us annoyed because we don't need you to fix it. We just need you to hear us. And that's the difference. If you're listening as a guy, you're going to be in the position to make suggestions and to try and solve the problem. If she just needs to be listened to, then you can just be quiet, right? Gets you off the hook, all right? Now, let's talk about these pheromones that I talked about, that we women and you men, P-H-E-R-E or O-M-O-N-E-S. They are scent molecules of affiliation. 8 out of 10 of us can perceive them, okay? 8 out of 10. We don't know why those two people can't, but we know that there's a special nerve in the brain. It sits in front of the nerve where perfume is perceived, the olfactory nerve, and it was only discovered about 5 years ago because it's very fragile and it's very tiny. And when we dissected brains, we destroyed it. We would just rip the lining off and that nerve would be gone. So there was all this discussion for years. People can't perceive pheromones. All the animals can, and butterflies and everybody else. But no, we do. And there are two little pits in the septum of your nose. That's how you perceive these, all right? So if I gave you 3 piles of t-shirts, your t-shirts, guy t-shirts, girl t-shirts, 8 out of 10 of you would pick out your t-shirt in a heartbeat. You know what you smell like, all right? You would also discriminate 7 out of 10 of you, guy shirts from girl shirts. Girls smell inherently sweet, and guys smell like musk. That's why it's an aftershave. It's a distinctly male scent. Now, this is not body odor scent. This is the unique smell of me, and it communicates many things. Okay, and I'm going to talk about what some of those things are. All right, so the first thing is that if I'm a mom, and I'm with my new baby right after it's born, and then the baby is given a breast pad from the mom and a stranger, a newborn baby will always turn to the breast pad of its mom. It knows the scent of its mom right away because it lived in our body. It went through birth. And if we spend time together, immediately that child is already learning the scent of our family. All right? Mothers, if they were with their baby right afterwards, if you blindfold them, they can pick out their baby by scent. Fathers can pick out their baby, but not by scent. What sense do you think the father uses to pick out his baby? Touch, back of his hand. A male will immediately know, if it's been with its baby, the unique feel of that baby's hand. I think that's awesome, right? Awesome stuff, all right? Now, this pheromone, these things communicate lots of things about family and who is in our family system, many, many things. But this thing that happened with my friend and I had to do with, as I said, this business of being in this community and needing to cycle together. And this first work was done by a woman in Chicago, and she went a step further. She'd observed the women in the dorm were all cycling together, but then her friend said to her, but I think I'm an alpha female. What do you mean by that? She said, everybody cycles with me. Okay, this is even better. Because you can collect pheromones and you can use them. You'd simply wear a t-shirt for 3 days and no smelly anything like soap or perfume. And then you can extract these pheromones and use them for an experiment. So she had two groups of women who'd never met each other or met Alpha Woman. One group got Alpha Woman's pheromones and rubbing alcohol under the nose every day for 3 months. And the other group just got rubbing alcohol. In 3 months, the women in Alpha Woman's group were cycling with Alpha Woman, and the other group was still on whatever cycle they were on, with the exception of the women in Alpha Woman's group who were contracepting. When we are contracepting, it destroys this ability, all right? We are in theory on somebody else's cycle, and so we do not cycle and respond to these pheromones, all right? Now, God gave us women a unique gift here, and that is that we women, when we meet a guy, all right, we are perceiving his pheromones. And some will smell really good to us and some will not. Now just because he smells nice does not mean you should marry him. That's only the first cut, all right? But he's worth looking at, all right? Because when we are attracted and we're not contracepting, we're attracted to a male, okay, who is a complement to us. There's only a little overlap. And what does this have to do with? It has to do with something called the MHC complex. These are the immune system markers that are in all of our cells. We perceive this male to be a good fertility possibility for us. Nature equipped us with this ability, all right? Equipped us. Now, if I am chemically contracepting, it changes my preference. And I am now attracted to a male by scent whose immune system is very much like my own. This is a fertility challenge, all right? If this couple marries, they're going to have trouble once they're done contracepting with conceiving. They're more likely to have miscarriages. They're more likely to have trouble conceiving stillbirths. Why? Because we are too much alike. And this is stuff now that the ecology people are writing about. They believe that across the world, where there are millions and millions and millions of women using chemical contraceptives, that we now have a generation of autoimmune compromised children. But remember, we're at least three generations in. We have more kids with asthma, we have more kids with allergies than ever before, and more sick kids than ever before. All right? There's a man by the name of Alexander Sanger who wrote a book called Beyond Choice. He is Margaret Sanger's grandson. He is Mr. International Planned Parenthood. He wrote a book called Beyond Choice. He described this is the first place I saw this information. And he said in there that the pill is horrendously bad medicine for the human race because it has changed our reproductive history and no one told us. Those are pretty strong words, all right? Very strong words. Now there's another issue here. If I am not pregnant and I go off the pill, I no longer find this man attractive to me. I might still love him, but he smells adverse. This will destroy people's intimacy. I know many people who, after hearing this talk, have come to me and said, oh my God, that's what happened in my first marriage. This will destroy your intimacy, all right? Because you don't smell good to each other, all right? Now, men, you perceive something different, all right? Men perceive fertility, this is all by pheromone, okay? When a woman is fertile, infertility, and pregnancy, all right? All by pheromones, and we intuitively know these things, all right? Now, when we women, let me say a word about this, when we women are ovulating, okay, here's our period. The first phase is called the follicular phase, okay? We have two ovaries that are the size of almonds, so they're nowhere near that big, two fallopian tubes that do not touch the ovaries, and that lead to the uterus, and the cervix is the entrance. All right? Now, the follicular phase, every other month we alternate which side is going to ovulate. 10 ovum begin to prepare themselves, and at midpoint here, which is 12 days from your next period, you will usually release one ovum. As women, we need to know this is our peak time when our brain is working best. Everything works better. You think better, you perceive better. Why? Because nature has one thing on its mind, and it's about reproduction. It's about choosing a partner. But there's some media effects research. They showed women who were ovulating erotic movies. All of them had an erotic response. they showed the women in the follicular phase and the luteal phase over here, the same movie, and they had a consistent response that it was a stupid, dirty movie, but no erotic response. This woman who saw this movie once, now shown this movie, at any time in her cycle will have an erotic response. The anthropologists say if you have sex with Mr. Wrong here, you're hooked. And Mr. Wrong is always followed by Mr. Wrong. Mr. Wrong number one is always followed by Mr. Wrong number two. Okay? We women need to be aware of this, but you guys need to be aware of this too. All right? So this question of fertility. If you are with an ovulating woman, you men have a physiological response. You're more sexually interested, you're more aggressive, and it's biology, all right? Women, you need to know that when you're ovulating, there's a couple other things that go on. You dress to impress. You dress differently. The Canadians did a piece of research, and they had a whole bunch of women. They did spit samples to see where they were hormonally, and then they took photos every day. And then they gave the photos to a bunch of strangers who'd never seen these women before. And at a far greater incidence than accident, they all picked out the ovulating women. Because we are signaling about reproduction here, okay? And it's also the case that if I am not chemically contracepting and I show you pictures of males versus women who are chemically contracepting, no real males present, the chemically contracepting women pick out the guy with the rugged, very rugged face, Mr. High Testosterone. Why is that a problem? Because he's going to impregnate and leave. He is not going to be a faithful partner. All right? But women not on the pill will pick out a male who has plenty of testosterone, but he's a much better partner. He's more likely to be a father, to be a husband, and to stay. So we get, there's all these pieces going on, okay? So this whole piece, the males are perceiving that we're fertile, all right? This is a time to be making smart choices, okay? Guys, if your girlfriend suddenly thinks that sex is a good idea, you're going to practice saying something. Ready? Daddy, daddy, daddy. Because if you have sex during ovulation, she is very likely to get pregnant. You have to decide, are you ready? You need to be men of honor. There's two people here. Do you want her to have to choose? Is she going to have an abortion? Are you ready to be a parent? Are you ready to be responsible for this new life? It's a huge responsibility. It's a blessing. But there's two people who can make choices here. And as teens, you know, college students, if sex seems like a good idea, take 24 hours and go think about it. Are you willing? Are you willing? Are you ready to be parents? Because we need to look at that, okay? We need to make good choices, and there's two people. You know, women go, but he says he'll leave me if I don't have sex with him. Women, here's your answer. There is no known case in the history of the world where a male has died because he didn't have sex. Okay? Ask if you can stay and watch, because if he dies, you're going to be on TV. This is going to be a big deal. You're going to get to, you know, you can say, I watched him, you know, it was right there before me. He just expired. But, you know, while I jest about that, it's also true. Anybody who loves you is going to be willing to wait for you, all right? And you have to decide what do you want in your life, okay? Now, infertility. This was the work of a man by the name of Lionel Tiger. And he believed that when we started chemically contracepting, which was invisible, that men no longer took responsible for their children, responsibility for babies that were conceived, because they didn't know if they were his or not, all right? Took a colony of monkeys to an island. The male was Austin. There were a bunch of females. Austin was absolutely faithful to three of these females. He paid no attention to any of the others. Fertile or not, nothing. When they put his females on contraceptives, he lost interest and he went and took up with other females. When they put the whole colony of females on contraceptives, Austin fared poorly. His sperm count dropped by half. He began to not have intercourse with any female, but to rape violently and randomly, and he masturbated excessively. When they took the females off, his sperm count came back. He no longer raped, and he stopped masturbation. Now, let me say to you, we live in a culture with millions of women who are on the pill. We know that male sperm counts have dropped by half since 1960, and part of this is because we women put all that estrogen in the water. This is a huge waste management issue in every country where chemical contraceptives exist. It's in the water, and we can't get it out. You men have suffered because you've lost 50% of your fertility since the 1960s. Your sperm counts have dropped very radically, and there are malformations in terms of genitalia and stuff because we can't get away from the estrogen. It's there. We drink it. It's in the water. Okay? Now, this question, Do we have random rape? Oh, yeah. Do we have lowered sperm count? Oh, yeah. Do we have excessive masturbation? Oh, sure we do. What's it called? Pornography. Yeah. Yeah. We need to know pornography is addiction. It is not sex. There is no satisfaction that comes with that. And the research shows that people who become excessively hooked on pornography actually have brain damage. There are holes in the brain, all right? We women should not tolerate this behavior. It does not enhance sexual activity because he's not being faithful to you. He's having a pretend relationship with some woman who's constantly available to him, who makes no demands on him. This isn't human love. This is a fake. And it doesn't enhance our relationships. We should not tolerate this. It's also not good for the men we love. It's an addiction. And it has to keep escalating, okay? And we think, well, these are all liberated. Isn't this wonderful, liberated women? They all want to do this. You people need to know that many of those women are sold into sexual slavery. They're also aspiring movie stars. It's the only way they can make money. And what's the problem? They have to keep escalating the level of the pornography. And you know where some of those women end up? Yeah, dead. Snuff flicks, they're called. Those are somebody's sisters. They could be your sisters. You got to think about it. That is an abuse of the dignity of women. All right? We can't tolerate that. So this infertility question, you males recognize that the females around you are not fertile. You are not picking up on this, all right? What about pregnancy? Well, men often perceive pregnancy by scent before their partner knows she's pregnant, okay? By this scent. But there's more to it, gentlemen, because you guys are changed by pregnancy. 60 to 80% of men are going to have symptoms of pregnancy with their partner. Learned that at the University of Minnesota 100 years ago. Primitive cultures knew men were changed by pregnancy, okay? And 20% of these men are really sick. And our doctors have never heard about this, so he goes to the doctor and goes, I'm really sick. I'm throwing up a lot. I'm really nauseous. I have headaches and backaches and toothaches. I'm not sleeping well, but I'm exhausted. I'm very anxious. And there's these other couple weird things. I have some food cravings. Yeah, and I've gained about 6 pounds. Doctor goes, oh, you got a virus. It'll go away. I'll tell you when it goes away. All right? 6 weeks before the baby comes, here's what happens to the father. His testosterone drops like a rock. He's more likely to stay. He's more gentle. He's more caring. His estrogen goes up. Because yes, men have estrogen. It makes him kinder and gentler when we women need protection because this baby is going to be born soon. All right? He gets a large dose of something called cortisol. That's our stress hormone, but he's not stressed in terms of being massively stressed. He's stressed enough to be protecting. And this hormone, interestingly, also has to do with bonding. Okay? Then he gets a large dose of vasopressin. Now let me say something about this. This is predominantly a male hormone. All right? Gentlemen, the concept of hookup sex and leaving is a physiological improbability and impossibility because when you have sexual intimacy with a woman, your body does not get the message that there isn't supposed to be connection. And you immediately begin bonding chemically to this woman. And this in particular is one of the hormones. This gives you preference for this female and makes you jealous and protective. The whole concept of sexuality in our society is such a lie. We can have sex without consequence. We can walk away. No problem. No, our body is changed by every sexual act of sexual intimacy, women or men, all right? We get oxytocin, which is a brain hormone. You guys get this vasopressin stuff, and I'll say a little more about women's bodies in a minute. He gets a lot of vasopressin here. It's Mother Nature. Sit, stay, all right? Now, when the baby comes, he gets prolactin. That's the nursing hormone. He's got it for at least 6 weeks. Women, make note, for 6 weeks, diapers and Starbucks at midnight. And then you got to plan ahead, okay? But this is about helping us as a family to bond, okay? Then when his hormones go back to normal, guess what? His testosterone never again goes as high as it was when he was a bachelor. Hardwired for fatherhood, changed forever. And in the animal kingdom, where monkeys, the male monkeys care for the young, and the sexuality issues in terms of humans and primates are pretty straight line. Those fathers get new brain cells, a lot of them, in the prefrontal cortex, the higher functioning part of the brain, and they stay until the young become independent. I'm willing to bet that happens to humans as well. You see, Men are changed by this experience. If my girlfriend's pregnant and I'm with her, I might know she's pregnant before she knows. And now this issue of what are we going to do with this pregnancy comes up. Well, we have an abortion. I will tell you that men suffer incredibly after abortions. We've done two conferences on men and abortions. They suffer as much as the women, but they hide. And if you have friends, guy friends, who've been involved in abortions, you keep an eye on them, people, because they're suicidal. And so are the women. If there's an abortion in a teenage woman, in the 6 months after that abortion, she's 10 times more likely to attempt a suicide. We don't know the numbers of guys, but it's there. I know it's there. I know people whose best friends have jumped off bridges, and the only people who knew were the friends. And the friends knew there was a girlfriend, a pregnancy, and an abortion. The family never knew. Okay?